Recorded Books presents The Particle at the End of the Universe, How the Hunt for the Higgs Boson Leads Us to the Edge of a New World by Sean Carroll. Narrated by Jonathan Hogan and directed by Ezra Tenenbaum. The author opens with a quote from Joe Incandela, spokesperson for the CMS collaboration at the Large Hadron Collider. People underestimate the impact of a new reality. And now, The Particle at the End of the Universe.
Prologue. Joanne Hewitt is feeling giddy, smiling broadly as she speaks enthusiastically into a video camera. An excited buzz filters up from partygoers at the Swiss consulate in San Francisco. It's a unique event, celebrating the first protons circulating in the underground tunnel of the Large Hadron Collider, LHC, outside Geneva, an enormous particle accelerator on the French-Swiss border that has begun its quest to unlock the secrets of the universe. The champagne flows freely, and no wonder. Hewitt's voice rises with emphasis. I've been waiting for this day for 25 years. It's a big moment. At this point in 2008, physicists have finally achieved what they have long insisted was necessary to make the next big step forward, a giant accelerator that would smash protons together at very high energies. For a while, they thought the United States was going to build such a machine, but things didn't work out as anticipated. Hewitt was just beginning graduate school in 1983 when the U.S. Congress first approved construction of the Superconducting Super Collider, SSC, in Texas. Slated to begin operation before the year 2000, it would have been the largest collider ever built. She, like so many of the brilliant and ambitious physicists of her generation, believed that discoveries there would form the foundation of their research careers. But the SSC was canceled, pulling the rug out from under physicists who had counted on it to shape the course of their field for decades to come. Politics and bureaucracy and infighting got in the way. Now, the LHC, similar in many ways to what the SSC would have been, is at long last about to fire up for the first time, and Hewitt and her colleagues are more than ready for it. What I've done over the past 25 years is take every new crazy theory that anybody's ever come up with and calculated its signature, how we identify new particles, at the SSC or LHC, she says. There is another, more personal reason for Hewitt's giddiness. In the video, her red hair is very short, almost a crew cut. It's not a fashion choice. Earlier in the year, she was diagnosed with invasive breast cancer with about a 1 in 5 chance that it would be terminal. She opted for an extremely aggressive treatment program involving harsh chemotherapy and a seemingly endless series of surgeries. Her trademark red hair, usually reaching down to her waist, disappeared quickly. At times, she admits with a laugh, she kept her spirits up by thinking about what new particles would be found at the LHC. Joanne and I have known each other for years, as friends and colleagues. My own expertise is primarily in cosmology, the study of the universe as a whole, which has recently enjoyed a golden age of new data and surprising discoveries. Particle physics, which has become inseparable from cosmology as an intellectual discipline, has nevertheless been starved for new experimental results that will upend the theoretical apple cart and lead us forward to new ideas. The pressure has been building for a long time. Another physicist at the party, Gordon Watts of the University of Washington, was asked whether the long anticipation for the LHC has been stressful. Oh yeah, completely. I have this shock of gray hair here now. My wife claims it's because of our kid, but it's really because of the LHC. Particle physics stands on the brink of a new era, in which some theories are going to come crashing down, and perhaps others will turn out to be right on the money. Every physicist at the party has their favorite models. Higgs bosons, supersymmetry, technicolor, extra dimensions, dark matter, a tumble of exotic ideas and fantastic implications. My hope for what the LHC will find is none of the above, Hewitt enthuses. I honestly think it's going to be a surprise, because I think nature is smarter than we are, and she's got some surprises in store for us, and we're going to have a hell of a fun time trying to figure it all out, and it's going to be great. That was 2008. In 2012, the San Francisco party to celebrate the inauguration of the LHC is over, and the era of discovery has been officially launched. Hewitt's hair has grown back, the treatments were agonizing, but they seem to have worked, and the experiment she's been anticipating for her entire career is making history. After 2.5 decades of theorizing, her ideas are finally being tested against real data. Particles and interactions never seen before by human beings. Surprises that nature has been keeping hidden from us until now. Jump to July 4th, 2012, opening day of the International Conference on High Energy Physics. It's a biannual gathering, moving from city to city around the world, this year winding up in Melbourne, Australia. Hundreds of particle physicists, Hewitt included, have filled the main auditorium to hear a special seminar. All the investment in the LHC, all the anticipation that has built up over the years, is about to pay off. The presentation itself is beamed to Melbourne from CERN, the laboratory in Geneva that is home to the LHC. There are two talks which would ordinarily have been presented in Melbourne as part of the conference program. At the last minute, however, the powers that be decided that a moment of this magnitude should be shared with the many people who had helped make the LHC such a success. The sentiment was appreciated. Hundreds of physicists at CERN have lined up for hours before the talks were scheduled to begin at 9 a.m. Geneva time, camping out overnight with sleeping bags in hopes of getting a good seat. Rolf Hoyer, General Director of CERN, introduces the proceedings. There will be talks by American physicist Joe Incandela and Italian physicist Fabiola Giannotti, the spokespersons for the two major experiments that worked to collect and analyze LHC data. Both experiments include more than 3,000 collaborators each, most of whom are glued to computer monitors scattered around the globe. The event is being live-streamed, not only to Melbourne, but to anyone who wants to hear the results in real time. It's an appropriate medium for this celebration of modern big science, a high-tech international effort with big stakes and exhilarating rewards. Traces of nervous energy are evident in both Giannotti's and Incandela's talks, but the presentations speak for themselves. They each give heartfelt thanks to the many engineers and scientists who helped make the experiments possible. Then they carefully explain why we should all believe the results they are about to present, demonstrating that they understand how their machines are working and that the analysis of the data is precise and reliable. Only after the stage has been immaculately set do they show us what they've found. And there it is. A handful of graphs that wouldn't seem like much to the untutored eye, but with a consistent feature, more events, collections of particles streaming from a single collision, than expected with a certain particular energy. All the physicists in the audience know immediately what it means, a new particle. The LHC has glimpsed a part of nature that had heretofore never been seen. Incandela and Giannotti go through the painstaking statistical analysis meant to separate true discoveries from unfortunate statistical fluctuations, and the results in both cases speak without ambiguity. This is something real. Applause in Geneva, Melbourne, and around the world. The data are so precise and clear that even scientists who had worked on the experiment for years are taken aback. Welsh physicist Lynn Evans, who, more than anyone else, was responsible for guiding the LHC through its rocky path to completion, declared himself gobsmacked at the exquisite agreement between the two experiments. I was at CERN myself that day, masquerading as a journalist in a press room next to the main auditorium. Journalists aren't supposed to clap at the news events they cover, but the assembled reporters gave in to the overwhelming emotion of the moment. This wasn't just a success for CERN or for physics. This was a success for the human race. We think we know what's been found, an elementary particle called the Higgs boson, after Scottish physicist Peter Higgs. Higgs himself was in the room for the seminars, 83 years old, and visibly moved. I never thought I'd see this happen in my lifetime. Several other senior physicists who had likewise proposed the same idea back in 1964 were also present. The conventions by which theories are named aren't always fair, but this was a moment where everyone could join in the celebration. So what is the Higgs boson? It's a fundamental particle of nature, of which there aren't many, and a very special kind of particle to boot. Modern particle physics knows of three kinds of particles. There are particles of matter, like electrons and quarks that constitute the atoms that make up everything we see. There are the force particles that carry gravity and electromagnetism, and the nuclear forces, which hold the matter particles together. And then there is the Higgs in its own unique category. The Higgs is important not for what it is, but for what it does. The Higgs particle arises from a field pervading space known as the Higgs field. Everything in the known universe, as it travels through space, moves through the Higgs field. It's always there, lurking invisibly in the background. And it matters. Without the Higgs, electrons and quarks would be massless, just like photons, the particles of light. They would move at the speed of light themselves, and it would be impossible to form atoms and molecules, much less life as we know it. The Higgs field isn't an active player in the dynamics of ordinary matter, but its presence in the background is crucial. Without it, the world would be an utterly different place, and now we've found it. Some words of caution are in order. What we actually have in hand is evidence for a very Higgs-like particle. It has the right mass, it is produced and decays in roughly the expected ways, but it's too early in the game to say for sure that what we've discovered is definitely the simple Higgs predicted by the original models. It could be something more complicated, or be part of an elaborate web of related particles. But we've definitely found some new particle, and it acts like we think a Higgs boson should. For the purposes of this book, I'm going to treat July 4th, 2012, as the day the discovery of the Higgs boson was announced. If reality turns out to be more subtle, then all the better for everyone. Physicists live for surprises. Hopes are high that the Higgs discovery represents the beginning of a new age in particle physics. We know that there is more to physics than we currently understand. Studying the Higgs offers a new window into worlds yet unseen. Experimenters like Giannotti and Incandela have a new specimen to study. Theorists like Hewitt have new clues to build better models. Our understanding of the universe has taken a huge, long-anticipated step forward. This is the story of the people who have devoted their lives to discovering the ultimate nature of reality, of which the Higgs is a crucial component. There are theorists sitting with pencil and paper, fueled by espresso and heated disputes with colleagues, turning over abstract ideas in their minds. There are engineers pushing machines and electronics well beyond the limits of existing technology. And most of all, there are the experimenters, bringing the machines and the ideas together to discover something new about nature. Modern physics at the cutting edge involves projects that cost billions of dollars and take decades to complete, requiring extraordinary devotion and a willingness to bet high stakes in search of unique rewards. When it all comes together, the world changes. Life is good. Have another glass of champagne. Chapter 1. The Point, in which we ask why a group of talented and dedicated people would devote their lives to the pursuit of things too small to be seen. Particle physics is a curious activity. Thousands of people spend billions of dollars building giant machines miles across, whipping around subatomic particles at close to the speed of light, and crashing them together, all to discover and study other subatomic particles that have essentially no impact on the daily lives of anyone who is not a particle physicist. That's one way of looking at it, anyway. Here's another way. Particle physics is the purest manifestation of human curiosity about the world in which we live. Human beings have always asked questions, and since the ancient Greeks more than 2 millennia ago, the impulse to explore has grown into a systematic, worldwide effort to discover the basic rules governing how the universe works. Particle physics arises directly from our restless desire to understand our world. It's not the particles that motivate us. It's our human desire to figure out what we don't understand. The early years of the 21st century are a turning point. The last truly surprising experimental result to emerge from a particle accelerator was in the 1970s, more than 35 years ago. The precise date would depend on your definition of surprising. It's not because the experimentalists have been asleep at the switch, far from it. The machines have improved by leaps and bounds, reaching into realms that seemed impossibly far away just a short time ago. The problem is that they haven't seen anything we didn't already expect them to see. For scientists who are always hoping to be surprised, that's extremely annoying. The problem, in other words, isn't that the experiments have been inadequate. It's that the theory has been too good. In the specialized world of modern science, the roles of experimentalists and theorists have become quite distinct, especially in particle physics. Gone are the days, as recent as the first half of the 20th century, when a genius like Italian physicist Enrico Fermi could propose a new theory of the weak interactions, then turn around and guide the construction of the first self-sustained artificial nuclear chain reaction. Today, particle theorists scribble equations on blackboards, which ultimately become specific models, which are tested by experimentalists who gather data from exquisitely precise machines. The best theorists keep close tabs on experiments and vice versa, but no one person is a master of both. The 1970s saw the finishing touches put on our best theory of particle physics, which goes by the fantastically uninspiring name of the Standard Model. It's the Standard Model that describes quarks, gluons, neutrinos, and all the other elementary particles you may have heard of. Like Hollywood celebrities or charismatic politicians, scientific theories are put on a pedestal just so we can tear them down. You don't become a famous physicist by showing that someone else's theory is right. You become famous by showing where someone else's theory goes wrong, or by proposing a better theory. But the Standard Model is stubborn. For decades now, every experiment that we can do here on Earth has duly confirmed its predictions. An entire generation of particle physicists has risen up the academic ladder from students to senior professors, all without having a single new phenomenon that they could discover or explain. The anticipation has been close to unbearable. All this is changing. The Large Hadron Collider represents a new era in physics, smashing together particles with an energy never before achieved by humankind. And it's not just higher energy, it's an energy we've been dreaming about for years, in which we expect to find new, theoretically predicted particles and hopefully some surprises. The energy where the force known as the weak interaction hides its secrets. The stakes are high. Peering into the unknown for the first time, anything could happen. There are scads of competing theoretical models hoping to anticipate what the LHC will find. You don't know what you're going to see until you look. At the center of the speculation lies the Higgs boson, an unassuming particle that represents both the last piece of the standard model and the first glimpse into the world beyond. A big universe made of little pieces. Near the Pacific coast in Southern California, about an hour and a half drive south of where I live in Los Angeles, there is a magical place where dreams come to life. Legoland. At Dino Island, Funtown, and other attractions, children marvel at an elaborate world constructed from Legos, tiny plastic blocks that can be fitted together in limitless combinations. Legoland is a lot like the real world. At any moment, your immediate environment typically contains all sorts of substances: wood, plastic, fabric, glass, metal, air, water, living bodies. Very different kinds of things with very different properties. But when you look more closely, you discover that these substances aren't truly distinct from one another. They are simply different arrangements of a small number of fundamental building blocks. These building blocks are the elementary particles. Like the buildings in Legoland, tables and cars and trees and people represent some of the amazing diversity you can achieve by starting with a small number of simple pieces and fitting them together in a variety of ways. An atom is about 1 trillionth the size of a Lego block, but the principles are similar. We take for granted the idea that matter is made of atoms. It's something we're taught in school, where we do chemistry experiments in classrooms with the periodic table of the elements hanging on the wall. It's easy to lose sight of how amazing that fact is. Some things are hard, some are soft, some things are light, some are heavy. Some things are liquid, some are solid, some are gas. Some things are transparent, some are opaque. Some things are alive, some are not. But beneath the surface, all these things are really the same kind of stuff. There are about 100 atoms listed in the periodic table, and everything around us is just some combination of those atoms. The hope that we can understand the world in terms of a few basic ingredients is an old idea. In ancient times, a number of different cultures, Babylonians, Greeks, Hindus, and others, invented a remarkably consistent set of 5 elements out of which everything else was made. The ones we are most familiar with are earth, air, fire, and water, but there was also a heavenly 5th element of ether, or quintessence. Yes, that's where the movie with Bruce Willis and Mila Jovovich got its name. Like many ideas, this one was developed into an elaborate system by Aristotle. He suggested that each element sought a particular natural state. For example, earth tends to fall and air tends to rise. By mixing the elements in different combinations, we could account for the different substances we see around us. Democritus, a Greek philosopher who predated Aristotle, originally suggested that everything we know is made of certain tiny, indivisible pieces, which he called atoms. It's an unfortunate accident of history that this terminology was seized upon by John Dalton, a chemist who worked in the early 1800s, to refer to the pieces that define chemical elements. What we now think of as an atom is not indivisible at all. It consists of a nucleus made of protons and neutrons, around which orbit a collection of electrons. Even the protons and neutrons aren't indivisible. They are made of smaller pieces called quarks. The quarks and electrons are the real atoms, in Democritus's sense of indivisible building blocks of matter. Today we call them elementary particles. 2 kinds of quarks, known playfully as up and down, go into making the protons and neutrons of an atomic nucleus. So all told, we need only three elementary particles to make up every single piece of matter that we immediately perceive in the environment around us. Electrons, up quarks, and down quarks. That's an improvement over the five elements of antiquity, and a big improvement over the periodic table. Boiling the world down to just three particles is a bit of an exaggeration, however. While electrons and up and down quarks are enough to account for cars and rivers and puppies, they aren't the only particles we've discovered. There are actually 12 different kinds of matter particles. 6 quarks that interact strongly and get confined inside larger collections like protons and neutrons, and 6 leptons that can travel individually through space. We also have force-carrying particles that hold them together in the different combinations we see. Without force particles, the world would be a boring place indeed. Individual particles would just move on straight lines through space, never interacting with one another. It's a fairly small set of ingredients to explain everything we see around us, but frankly, it could be simpler. Modern particle physicists are driven by a desire to do better. The Higgs boson. That's the standard model of particle physics. 12 matter particles, plus a group of force-carrying particles to hold them all together. Not the tidiest picture in the world, but it fits all the data. We have assembled all the pieces needed to successfully describe the world around us, at least here on Earth. Out in space, we find evidence for things like dark matter and dark energy, stubborn reminders that we certainly don't understand everything yet. These are most certainly not explained by the standard model. For the most part, the standard model divides nicely into matter particles and force-carrying particles. The Higgs boson is different. Named after Peter Higgs, who was one of several people who proposed the idea back in the 1960s, the Higgs boson is somewhat of an ugly duckling. Technically speaking, it's a force-carrying particle, but it's a different kind of force carrier from the ones we're most familiar with. From the viewpoint of a theoretical physicist, the Higgs seems like an arbitrary and whimsical addition to an otherwise beautiful structure. If it weren't for the Higgs boson, the standard model would be the epitome of elegance and virtue. As it is, it's a bit of a mess, and finding the mess maker has proven to be quite a challenge. So why were so many physicists convinced that the Higgs boson must exist? You'll hear explanations like to give mass to other particles and to break symmetries, both of which are true, but not easy to absorb at first glance. The main point is that without the Higgs boson, the standard model would look very different and not at all like the real world. With the Higgs boson, it's a perfect match. Theoretical physicists certainly tried their best to come up with theories that didn't have a Higgs boson, or one in which the boson was quite different from the standard story. Many of the theories failed when confronted with the data, and others seemed unnecessarily complicated. None looked like a true upgrade. And now, we found it. Or something very much like it. Depending on how careful physicists are being, they will say either, we've discovered the Higgs boson, or we've discovered a Higgs-like particle, or even, we've discovered a particle that resembles the Higgs. The July 4th announcement described a particle that behaves very much like the Higgs is supposed to behave. It decays into certain other particles in more or less the ways we expect it to. But it's still early, and as we collect more data, there is plenty of room for surprises. Physicists don't want it to be the Higgs we all expect. It's always more interesting and fun to find something unexpected. There are already tiny hints in the data that this new particle might not be exactly the Higgs we expect. Only further experiments will reveal the truth. Why we care. I was once interviewed by a local radio station about particle physics, gravitation, cosmology, things like that. It was 2005, the centenary of Albert Einstein's miraculous year of 1905, in which he published a handful of papers that turned the world of physics on its head. I did my best to explain some of these abstract concepts, waving my hands up and down, which I can't help but do even when I know I'm on the radio. The interviewer seemed happy, but after we finished and he was packing up his recording gear, a light bulb went off in his head. He asked if I would answer one more question. I said, sure, and he once again deployed his microphone and headphones. The question was simple. Why should anybody care? None of this research is going to lead to a cure for cancer or a cheaper smartphone, after all. The answer I came up with still makes sense to me. When you're 6 years old, everyone asks these questions. Why is the sky blue? Why do things fall down? Why are some things hot and others cold? How does it all work? We don't have to learn how to become interested in science. Children are natural scientists. That innate curiosity is beaten out of us by years of schooling and the pressures of real life. We start caring about how to get a job, meet someone special, raise our own kids. We stop asking how the world works and start asking how we can make it work for us. Later, I found studies showing that kids love science up until the ages of 10 to 14 years old. These days, after pursuing science seriously for more than 400 years, we actually have quite a few answers to offer the 6-year-old inside each of us. We know so much about the physical world that the unanswered questions are to be found in remote places and extreme environments. That's physics, anyway. In fields like biology or neuroscience, we have no difficulty at all asking questions to which the answers are still elusive. But physics, at least the subfield of elementary physics, which looks for the basic building blocks of reality, has pushed the boundaries of understanding so far that we need to build giant accelerators and telescopes just to gather new data that won't fit into our current theories. Over and over again in the history of science, basic research, pursued just for the sake of curiosity, not for any immediate tangible benefit, has proven, almost despite itself, to lead to enormous tangible benefits. Way back in 1831, Michael Faraday, one of the founders of our modern understanding of electromagnetism, was asked by an inquiring politician about the usefulness of this newfangled electricity stuff. His apocryphal reply, "I know not, but I wager that one day your government will tax it." Evidence for this exchange is sketchy, but it's a sufficiently good story that people keep repeating it. A century later, some of the greatest minds in science were struggling with a new field of quantum mechanics, driven by a few puzzling experimental results that ended up overthrowing the basic foundations of all of physics. It was fairly abstract at the time, but subsequently led to transistors, lasers, superconductivity, light-emitting diodes, and everything we know about nuclear power and nuclear weapons. Without this basic research, our world today would look like a completely different place. Even general relativity, Einstein's brilliant theory of space and time, turns out to have down-to-earth applications. If you've ever used a global positioning system, GPS device, to find directions somewhere, you've made use of general relativity. A GPS unit, which you might find in your cell phone or car navigation system, takes signals from a series of orbiting satellites and uses the precise timing of those signals to triangulate its way to a location here on the ground. But according to Einstein, clocks in orbit, and therefore in a weaker gravitational field, tick just a bit faster than those at sea level. A small effect, to be sure, but it builds up. If relativity weren't taken into account, GPS signals would gradually drift away from being useful, Over the course of just one day, your location would be off by a few miles. But technological applications, while important, are ultimately not the point for me or Joanne Hewitt or any of the experimentalists who spend long hours building equipment and sifting through data. They're great when they happen, and we won't turn up our noses if someone uses the Higgs boson to find a cure for aging, but it's not why we are looking for it. We're looking because we are curious. The Higgs is the final piece to a puzzle we've been working on solving for an awful long time. Finding it is its own reward. The Large Hadron Collider. We wouldn't have found the Higgs without the Large Hadron Collider, another dreary name for an inspiring embodiment of the human passion for discovery. The LHC is the largest, most complex machine ever built by human beings, and it came in at a cool $9 billion. The scientists who work at CERN hope it will run productively for 50 years, but they aren't that patient. It would be nice to get some world-changing discoveries right away, thank you very much. The LHC is gargantuan in every way it can be measured. It was first dreamed up in the 1980s, and approval to start building was given in 1994. Well before it was turned on, the LHC had made big news as lawsuits attempted to halt its construction on the grounds that it might produce world-consuming black holes. Those were successfully squashed, and the giant collider went to work in earnest in 2009. Around the world, on December 13, 2011, physicists and quite a few interested onlookers huddled in seminar rooms and around computer terminals to listen to two talks by researchers from the LHC. The subject was the search for the Higgs boson. This kind of topic is a very frequent subject for physics seminars, and the message is almost always, "The search is going well. Wish us luck." This time was different. Rumors had sped around the internet for several days before, hinting that we weren't just going to get the usual message. This time, they would be saying, "Okay, we might actually be seeing something. Maybe we finally found evidence that the Higgs boson is really there." The answer is yes. There were hints that the LHC was actually seeing the Higgs. Just hints, mind you, not the final word. The LHC smashed protons together at unbelievable energies, and two giant experimental detectors looked at what particles emerged from those collisions. The number of times that two high-energy photons, particles of light, were produced at a certain energy was just a smidgen bigger than we would have expected if there were no Higgs boson. Evidence that something was likely going on, to be sure, but not yet a discovery. But everything smelled right. Rolf Hoyer ended the press conference with a flourish. "See you next year with a discovery." And so they did. On July 4th, 2012, two more seminars brought us an update on the search for the Higgs. This time it wasn't a matter of tantalizing hints. They had found a new particle without question. Thousands of physicists around the world clapped with joy, but also exhaled with relief. The LHC was a success. Crossroads. Particle physics stands at a critical threshold. It's a foundational part of the human race's long-standing quest to better understand how the universe works. It's also very expensive, and its future is unclear. The search for the Higgs boson isn't just a story of subatomic particles and esoteric ideas. It's also a tale of money, politics, and jealousy. A project that involves so many people, unprecedented international cooperation, and more than a few technological breakthroughs doesn't happen without a certain amount of conniving, dealing, and occasional skullduggery. The LHC isn't the first giant particle accelerator that aimed to find the Higgs. There was the Tevatron at Fermi National Accelerator Laboratory, Fermi Lab, just outside Chicago, which turned on in 1983 and finally turned off in September 2011. After a productive lifespan that included the discovery of the top quark, but no Higgs. There was the Large Electron-Positron Collider, LEP, which ran from 1989 to 2000 in the same underground tunnel where the LHC now sits. Rather than colliding relatively massive protons, which tend to create messy splashes of particles when they meet, LEP collided electrons and their antimatter siblings, positrons. That configuration made it possible to do very precise measurements, but none of those measurements revealed the Higgs. And then there was the superconducting supercollider, or SSC, to which Hewitt wistfully referred. The SSC was the American version of the LHC, only bigger, better, and scheduled to be ready first. Proposed in the 1980s, the SSC planned to run at energies almost three times as high as the LHC will someday reach, five times as high as it's achieving right now. But the LHC can boast one enormous advantage over the SSC. It got built. After only a couple of years of running, the LHC has bequeathed to us a genuine discovery, a particle that looks very much like the Higgs boson. It's the end of one era, but also the beginning of another. The Higgs is not merely one more particle, it's a special kind of particle, one that can very naturally interact with other kinds of particles we haven't yet detected. We know the standard model is not the final answer. The dark matter mapped out by astronomers is clear evidence of that. The Higgs could be the portal that connects our world with another one lurking just out of our reach. Having found a new particle, we have decades of work ahead of us learning about its properties and where else it might lead. The long-term future of experimental particle physics remains murky. A century, or even 50 years ago, it was possible to make a foundational discovery in particle physics with the kind of equipment that could be set up by an individual scientist and a team of students. Those days might be over. If the LHC gives us the Higgs and nothing else, it will be increasingly difficult to convince skeptical governments to allocate even more money to build a next-generation collider. A machine like the LHC represents an investment of billions of dollars, but also of thousands of person-years of effort from dedicated scientists who are devoting their lives to dig just a little bit deeper into nature's mysteries. People like Lynn Evans, who helped build the LHC, or Joanne Hewitt, who studied countless theoretical models, or Fabiola Giannotti and Joe Incandela, who led their experiments to a historic achievement, have placed an enormous wager. They have gambled that this machine will usher in a new age of discovery, and the stakes they've placed are many years of their professional lives. Finding the Higgs is a vindication of all the work they've done. But, as Hewitt says, what we really want is to be surprised, to discover something nobody anticipated. That's what would really get our minds going. Historically, nature has been very good at surprising us. Chapter 2. Next to Godliness. In which we explore how the Higgs boson really has nothing to do with God, but is nevertheless pretty important. Leon Letterman has had second thoughts. He knows what he has done, but he can't take it back. It's just one of those small things that has enormous, unexpected consequences. We're speaking, of course, of the God particle. Not the particle itself, which is just the Higgs boson, but the name God particle, for which Letterman is responsible. One of the world's great experimental physicists, Letterman won the Nobel Prize in Physics in 1988 for discovering that there is more than one type of neutrino. If he hadn't won it for that, he has other achievements that would also be prize-worthy, including the discovery of a new kind of quark. There are only three known neutrinos, and 6 known quarks, so these kinds of achievements aren't exactly growing on trees. In his spare time, he has served as the director of Fermilab and has founded the Illinois Mathematics and Science Academy. Letterman is also a charismatic personality, famous among his colleagues for his humor and storytelling ability. One of his favorite anecdotes relates the time when, as a graduate student, he arranged to bump into Albert Einstein while walking the grounds at the Institute for Advanced Study at Princeton. The great man listened patiently as the eager youngster explained the particle physics research he was doing at Columbia, and then said, with a smile, "That is not interesting." But in the public eye, Letterman is better known for something less felicitous, saddling the world with the phrase God particle to refer to the Higgs boson. Indeed, that's the title of an engaging book on particle physics and the search for the Higgs that he wrote with Dick Teresi. As the authors explain in the first chapter of their book, they chose the phrase in part because the publisher wouldn't let us call it the goddamn particle, though that might be a more appropriate title, given its villainous nature and the expense it's causing. Physicists around the world, a notoriously fractious bunch, will happily agree on one thing. They hate the name God particle. Peter Higgs, from whom the more traditional name derives, says with a laugh, "I was really rather annoyed about that book, and I think I'm not the only one." Meanwhile, journalists around the world, who can be quite contentious in their own right, find unanimity on a single point. They love the name God particle. One of the safest bets in the world is that if you find an article in the popular press about the Higgs boson, at some point the piece will call it the God particle. You can hardly blame the journalists. As names go, God particle is totally box office, while Higgs boson comes off as a bit inscrutable. But you can't blame the physicists either. The Higgs has nothing whatsoever to do with God. It's just a really important particle, one that's worth getting excited about, even if that excitement doesn't quite rise to the level of religious ecstasy. It's worth understanding why physicists might be tempted to bestow godlike status on this humble elementary particle, even if it's actually free of any theological implications whatsoever. Does anyone really think God plays favorites among the particles? The mind of God. Physicists have a long and complicated relationship with God, not just with the hypothetical omnipotent being who created the universe, but with the word God itself. When they talk about the universe, physicists will often use the idea of God to express something about the physical world. Einstein was famous for this. Among the most frequently repeated quotes from this eminently quotable scientist are, "I want to know God's thoughts. The rest are details." And of course, "I am convinced that God does not play dice with the universe." Many of us have given in to the temptation of following in Einstein's footsteps. In 1992, a NASA satellite called the Cosmic Background Explorer, COBE, released amazing images of tiny ripples in the background radiation left over from the Big Bang. The significance of the event moved George Smoot, one of the investigators behind COBE, to say, "If you're religious, it's like looking at God." And Stephen Hawking, in the concluding paragraph of his mega-selling A Brief History of Time, doesn't shy away from using theological language. However, if we do discover a complete theory, it should, in time, be understandable in broad principle by everyone, not just a few scientists. Then we shall all, philosophers, scientists, and just ordinary people, be able to take part in the discussion of the question of why it is that we and the universe exist. If we find the answer to that, it would be the ultimate triumph of human reason, for then we would know the mind of God. Historically, some of the world's most influential physicists have been quite religious. Isaac Newton, arguably the greatest scientist of all time, was a devout, if somewhat heterodox, Christian who spent as much time studying and interpreting the Bible as he did with physics. In the 20th century, we have the example of Georges Lemaître, a cosmologist who developed the primeval atom theory, what is now known as the Big Bang model. Lemaître was a priest as well as a professor at the Catholic University of Leuven in Belgium. In the Big Bang model, our observable universe began at a singular moment of infinite density about 13.7 billion years ago. In the Christian account, our universe was created by God at some moment in time. There are obvious parallels between the two stories, but Lemaître was always extremely careful not to mix his religion with science. At one point, Pope Pius XII tried to suggest that the primeval atom could be identified with "Let There Be Light" from Genesis, but Lemaître himself persuaded him to drop that line of reasoning. Today, however, most working physicists are much less likely to believe in God than are members of the general public. When you study the workings of the natural world for a living, you tend to be impressed by how well the universe gets along all by itself without any supernatural assistance. There are certainly prominent examples of religious physicists, but just as certainly, the real work of physics gets along without allowing anything other than the natural world into the equation. God talk. So if physicists aren't big believers in God, why do they keep talking about him? Two reasons, actually. One good, one less so. The good reason is simply that God provides a very convenient metaphor for talking about the universe. When Einstein says, "I want to know God's thoughts," he isn't thinking of a literal supernatural being that the Pope might be imagining. He's expressing an inner desire to understand the fundamental workings of reality. There is an amazing fact about the universe. It makes sense. We can study what happens to matter under various circumstances, and we find astonishing regularities that never seem to be violated. When these regularities are established as real, beyond reasonable doubt, we call them laws of nature. The actual laws of nature are very interesting, but it's also interesting that there are laws at all. The laws we've discovered to date take the form of precise and elegant mathematical statements. The physicist Eugene Wigner was so moved by this feature of reality that he spoke of the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics in physics. Our universe isn't simply a hodgepodge of stuff doing random things. It's a highly orderly and predictable evolution of fixed constituents of matter, an intricately choreographed dance of particles and forces. When physicists speak metaphorically of God, they are simply giving in to the natural human tendency to anthropomorphize the physical world to give it a human face. God's thoughts are code for the underlying laws of nature. We want to know what those laws are. More ambitiously, we'd like to know if those laws could possibly have been different. Are the actual laws of nature just one set among many possible ones? Or is there something unique and special about our world? We may or may not be able to answer such a grandiose question, but it's the kind of thing that lights the imagination of working scientists. The other reason scientists succumb to God talk is a bit less lofty. Public relations. Calling the Higgs boson the God particle might be wildly inaccurate, but it's marketing genius. Physicists react to the God particle label with horror and disdain, but it draws eyeballs, which is why it will continue to be used, even though every journalist who covers science knows exactly what the physicists think of the term. God particle gets people to sit up and take notice. Once that phrase has been coined, there's no way it won't be used by everyone trying to explain this esoteric concept to a public with other demands on their attention. Say you are looking for the Higgs boson, and many people will change the channel. Maybe the Kardashians have done something outrageous. Say you're looking for the God particle, and people will at least pay attention when you explain what you mean. The Kardashians will still be acting up tomorrow. Occasionally, this kind of colorful language gets scientists in trouble. In 1993, when the United States was still planning to build a superconducting supercollider that would be even more powerful than the LHC, Nobel laureate Steven Weinberg was testifying before Congress on the virtues of the new machine. At one point, the questions took an unexpected turn. Representative Harris Faywell, I wish sometimes we had some one word that could say it all, and that is kind of impossible. I guess perhaps, Dr. Weinberg, you came a little close to it, and I'm not sure, but I took this down. You said you suspect that it isn't all an accident, that there are rules which govern matter. And I jotted down, will this make us find God? I'm sure you didn't make that claim, but it certainly will enable us to understand so much more about the universe. Representative Don Ritter, will the gentleman yield on that? If the gentleman would yield for a moment, I would say, Faywell, I'm not sure I want to. Ritter, if this machine does that, I am going to come round and support it. Weinberg wasn't so gauche as to refer to the Higgs boson as the God particle during his congressional testimony, but the lure of metaphor is strong, and at some point, talking about the workings of reality leads one to ask this kind of question. In case there is any remaining ambiguity, nothing we might find at the Large Hadron Collider or might have found at the superconducting supercollider will make us find God. But we will come closer to understanding the ultimate laws of nature. The final piece. Letterman and Teresi didn't dub the Higgs boson the God particle just because they knew it would get attention, although the prospect probably crossed their minds. In the end, the flamboyant nomenclature attracted as much bad attention as good. As they put it in the preface to a revised edition of their book, the title ended up offending two groups. One, those who believe in God, and two, those who do not. We were warmly received by those in the middle. What they were trying to do was express the importance of the Higgs boson. The book you're reading right now has a slightly more modest title, but only slightly. To be honest, physicists don't react with unalloyed approval when I tell them about the particle at the end of the universe. As far as we know, there isn't any end to the universe, either at some location in space or at some future moment in time. And if there were a location where the universe could be said to end, there's no reason to think you would find a particle there. And if you did, there's no reason to think it would be the Higgs boson. But once again, what we're dealing with here is a metaphor. The Higgs isn't located at the spatial or temporal end of the universe. It's located at the explanatory end. It's the final piece of the puzzle of how the ordinary matter that makes up our everyday world works at a deep level. That's pretty important. I should quickly rush in with caveats before my fellow physicists get upset again. The Higgs isn't the missing piece of the puzzle of absolutely everything. Finding the Higgs and measuring its properties leaves plenty of physics still to understand. There's gravity, for one thing, an entire force of nature that we can't quite reconcile with the demands of quantum mechanics, and we don't expect the Higgs to be of any help there. There are also dark matter and dark energy, mysterious substances that pervade the universe and yet have resisted direct detection here on Earth. There are other hypothetical exotic particles, the kind theoretical physicists love to invent, but for which we currently have no evidence. And then, needless to say, there are all the parts of science that present their own challenges without much crucial input from particle physics at all, from atomic and molecular physics, up through chemistry and biology and geology, all the way to sociology and psychology and economics. The human desire to understand the world will not reach a triumphant conclusion just because we have discovered the Higgs boson. With all those disclaimers out of the way, let's get back to emphasizing the singular role of the Higgs. It's the final part of the standard model of particle physics. The standard model explains everything we experience in our everyday lives, other than gravity, which is easy enough to tack on, quarks, neutrinos, and photons, heat, light, and radioactivity, tables, elevators, and airplanes, televisions, computers, and cell phones, bacteria, elephants, and people. Asteroids, planets, and stars, all simply applications of the standard model in different circumstances. It's the full theory of immediately discernible reality. And it all fits together beautifully, passing a bewildering variety of experimental tests as long as there is the Higgs boson. Without the Higgs, or something even more bizarre to take its place, the standard model wouldn't get off the ground. Figuring out the trick. There's something fishy about these claims that the Higgs boson is so important. After all, before we actually found it, how did we know it was important at all? What drove us to keep talking about the properties of a hypothetical particle nobody had ever observed? Imagine you see a performance by a very talented magician who performs an amazing card trick. The trick involves getting a playing card to mysteriously levitate in the air. You're puzzled by this trick, and you're absolutely sure that the magician didn't actually use mystical powers to make the card levitate. You're also clever and persistent, and after quite a bit of thinking, you come up with a way the magician could have done it, involving a thin thread secretly attached to the card. In fact, you're able to come up with other possible schemes involving blowing air and heat pumps, but the thread scenario is both simple and plausible. You even go so far as to reproduce the trick at home, convincing yourself that with the right kind of thread, you're able to do the trick just like the magician did. But you go back to catch another performance of the magician's act, where you are able to see the card levitate once again. His version looks just like the one you were able to put together at home, but try as you might, you can't quite see the thread itself. The standard model Higgs boson is like that thread. For a long time, we hadn't seen it directly, but we saw its effects. Or even better, we saw features of the world that make perfect sense if it's there and make no sense without it. Without the Higgs boson, particles such as the electron would have zero mass and move at the speed of light. But instead, they do have mass and move more slowly. Without the Higgs boson, many elementary particles would appear identical to one another. But instead, they are manifestly different, with a variety of masses and lifetimes. With the Higgs, all these features of particle physics make perfect sense. In circumstances like these, whether we're thinking about the levitating card or the Higgs boson, there are two options. Our theory is right, or an even more interesting and elaborate theory is right. The effects are there, the card floats, the particles have mass. There must be an explanation. If it's the simple one, we'll congratulate ourselves on our cleverness. If it's something more complicated, we'll have learned something very interesting. Maybe the particle we found at the LHC does part of what the Higgs was proposed to do, but not all of it. Or maybe the job of the Higgs is played by multiple particles, of which we've only found one. We win no matter what, as long as we ultimately succeed in figuring out what's going on. Fermions and bosons. Let's see if we can't translate this inspirational metaphorical cheerleading about how important the Higgs boson is into a more specific explanation for what it actually is supposed to do. Particles come in two types: the particles that make up matter, known as fermions, and the particles that carry forces, known as bosons. The difference between the two is that fermions take up space, while bosons can pile on top of one another. You can't just take a pile of identical fermions and put them all at the same place. The laws of quantum mechanics won't allow it. That's why collections of fermions make up solid objects like tables and planets. The fermions can't be squeezed on top of one another. In particular, the smaller the mass of the particle, the more space it takes up. Atoms are made out of just three types of fermions: up quarks, down quarks, and electrons, held together by forces. The nucleus, made of protons and neutrons, which in turn are made of up and down quarks, is relatively heavy and exists in a relatively tiny region of space. The electrons, meanwhile, are much lighter about 1/2000th the mass of a proton or neutron, and take up much more space. It's really the electrons in atoms that give matter its solidity. Bosons don't take up any space at all. 2 bosons, or 2 trillion bosons, can easily sit at exactly the same location right on top of one another. That's why bosons are force-carrying particles. They can combine to make a macroscopic force field, like the gravitational.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.